Hey, Jambareeqi.
Oh, hi, Sean.
Happy 50th episode.
Oh, thanks, man.
I got you a present.
Oh, it's really sweet of you. Oh, what is it?
It's shaving foam, Jambareeqi.
So it is.
I'm going to have you shave.
No, what?
No, I'm fine.
That's not how you shave!
Are you sure?
I'm really sure.
Oh, I'm sorry. This is a horrible gift.
Jambareeqi here, and welcome to the 50th episode of my review series. Now, a lot of people assume that my country of Britain just makes Wallace and Gromit shorts. No. You see, the British animation industry is broader than that. I mean, Aardman isn't the only studio in England that makes cartoons. There's so much things that we offer. In this episode, we're going to take a look at Watership Down. A film that's considered to be one of the greatest British animated features of all time.
Watership Down is a British hand-drawn animated adventure film. What's its story? Well, Hazel and Fiver are two rabbits living in a warren where they are treated poorly by bigger rabbits. When Fiver starts getting visions of horror, he insists that everyone leaves the warren immediately. So, Hazel, Fiver, and a group of other willing rabbits escape the warren in search of a new home. After a grueling journey, the rabbits settle down in an empty and peaceful new warren of their own. Unfortunately, they do not have any does to help their new colony reproduce. So, after trying a few different ways of gaining new rabbits for their warren, Hazel and his followers decide to rescue some rabbits from a totalitarian colony run by a cruel chief called General Woundwort. Now, I've only read a quarter of the original Watership Down novel by Richard Adams, because I'm still in the middle of reading it. To be honest, due to the fact I've not finished the book, I do not think that I'm fully qualified to draw an overall comparison between this animated film and its source material. There are bound to be other reviews of this movie online by people who are far more capable of contrasting the movie with the book. So, the question for me is, what did I think of Watership Down, the animated film? Well, I think that it's fantastic, touching, moving, and engaging, but I have one problem with it. The first half of its running time goes way too fast. This means that many of the opening scenes lack tension, characters are hard to connect to, and conflicts are solved in the blink of an eye. The pace of the first half is too energetic and seems more interested in pushing the story forward than creating an atmosphere, generating thrills, or developing the characters. I struggle to put myself in the position of the rabbits in the first half of the movie because the story is being told so frantically at the beginning. However, towards the halfway point of the film, the storytelling pace starts to improve. Round about when a rabbit called Bigwig gets caught in a trap, which is half an hour into the film. It's from here that scenes begin to be directed with more care and patience. Thanks to this slower pace, I had more time to sympathize with the rabbits and felt tenser when I watched them encounter dangers. It's a shame that the film sets itself up at a breakneck speed because what follows are some very exciting scenes that are supported by a coherent pace and a tense atmosphere. It's very captivating to watch our heroes rescue the poor rabbits from General Woundwort's warren, because they have to rely on their natural instincts, strength, wit, and courage. The rescue takes a team effort. It's exciting watching everyone work together in order to save some helpless rabbits from their cruel leader. They are willing to risk their lives to save these rabbits, while also offering them the opportunity of living in a more free warren. This makes our protagonist seem righteous and courageous. Now, it's inevitable that I talk about the film's most iconic scene. I mean, I can't make this review without bringing up this particular scene. After Hazel is shot by a farmer, Fiver begins to chase a vision of a black rabbit who leads him to his injured brother. Some people don't like this part of the film. Why? Well, they don't like the idea of a fantasy sequence taking place in what they believe is a completely realistic movie. However, It's already implied that Fiverr is psychic, so the introduction of a fantasy sequence isn't that inconsistent. Personally, I like this fantasy sequence. The gorgeous visuals, haunting song, and mysterious fog create a flow of images and music that are beautiful, yet also oddly depressing too. One thing I admired about the film is its depiction of humans. You see, so many films focused on wildlife characters depict mankind, when they're a threat, as over-the-top cartoon villains. So it's a fresh change to see man portrayed as regular everyday folk. Sure, the human characters do harm and kill the rabbits, but they're written as realistic threats and not supervillains from Captain Planet. They're just typical rural British farmers. In addition, we do hear a human snapping at a cat for torturing a rabbit. This shows that not all the humans in the film are cruel to animals. It gives a balanced depiction of humankind. Before I move on, I should briefly discuss the debate on whether Watership Down is a kids' movie. Well, personally, I see this film as a family movie, a film for everyone. Sure, kids can watch it, but its mature story, bloody violence, profanity, and realistic character designs make it seem appealing to adults as well as kids. I mean, just because it's a film about animals doesn't mean that it's not for adults. Felidae and Fritz the Cat are two animated animal movies directly aimed at adults. They contain content that's certainly not suitable for children. Sure, there are loads of talking animal movies aimed squarely at young children, but that doesn't mean that all talking animal movies are just for kids. Hazel is charming, polite, practical, brave, intelligent, and has great leadership skills. I really liked Hazel because even though he's sometimes overambitious with his plans, he has good intentions and will use his head in times of need. There's something comforting about Hazel. He seems mature and thoughtful. Then there's Hazel's brother Fiverr, a paranoid and fidgety rabbit who is constantly worrying. It's implied that he may be psychic because he can sense future danger. I'm going to be honest. Fiverr kind of annoyed me. Sure, his predictions and warnings are helpful for the Warren, but he spends the whole movie squirming and whimpering. He rarely calms down and comes across as a bit of a coward. Now, I know why he's frightened a lot. It's because he's always seeing terrifying visions of the future, but he's always frightened. All he ever does is be scared. So I found him to be a chicken-hearted stick in the mud. Many rabbits join Fiverr and Hazel on their journey. One of those rabbits is Bigwig. When Bigwig is first introduced, he's seen as a tough and confident rabbit. But after he's caught in a trap, he starts to expose his vulnerability as we see that he is capable of getting scared. This adds dimension to his character because we know that there's a sensitive rabbit underneath his hard exterior. However, unlike Fiverr, he doesn't spend the whole movie in a state of panic. His encounter with danger does make him more open to expose his fear, but he still has enough guts to risk his life to protect others. Then there's Kiha, an injured bird who is restored back to health by Hazel and his warren. Kiha is a perfect addition to the film because he provides comic relief, which helps soften the dark content and harsh spirit of the film. He's optimistic, goofy, energetic, and very funny because he's so hilariously silly. The film's main antagonist, General Woundwort, is a manipulative, threatening, intimidating, violent, and cruel villain. He's the kind of bad guy that you love to hate. You know, the kind you want to boo and hiss at whenever you see him. He's spiteful and despicable, but he also has a terrifying scream presence. Unlike most traditional animated villains, the general's motive is to protect his power, not to gain power. What makes him scary is that we can tell how far he will go to retain his authority. He will shed blood and humiliate rabbits in order to stay in his position of power. That's very frightening. I'll be honest and admit that I thought that the animation isn't as impressive as I remembered it to be. In my head, I recalled it being far more fluid and detailed than it really is. However, that's not to say that the animation for Watership Down is bad. No way, not at all, I am not saying that. I think that it's a pretty damn good effort. Expressions are readable, the animal's body movements are realistic, and each character has their own unique physical personality. It's just disappointed me that it's not as fluid and gorgeous as I remember. I shouldn't complain that the animation doesn't look like it does in my memories though, it's already pretty outstanding in terms of personality, body movement, and emotion. The voice acting for this movie is outstanding thanks to a brilliant voice cast. John Hurt, from The Elephant Man, provides the voice of Hazel, and I believe that he's perfect. He gives Hazel a soft and calm voice that also manages to convey a convincing level of confidence. Then there's Richard Briers as Fiver. Briers gives Fiver a timid voice that's well suited for his fragile character. Briers is best known for narrating the classic British cartoon Rhubarb, so he had some experience in voice acting prior to the production of Watership Down. Bigwig is voiced by Michael Graham Cox. Cox gives his character a stern and tenacious voice, but he doesn't make Bigwig sound like a brute. By performing his lines with a variety of suitable emotions, Cox makes Bigwig sound emotionally and physically strong. The comic actor Zero Mostel lends his chords to the character of Kiha. While Mostel may sound over the top and ridiculous in the role of Kiha, his performance is well suited for the part because he's supposed to be the film's comic relief. My only problem is that Mostel has a habit of barking his lines, which makes some of his dialogue hard to understand. However, it's Mostel's wacky delivery that makes Kiha sound as funny as he is. Harry Andrews voices the villainous General Woundwort, and he does a fantastic job at it. He sounds aggressive, vile, and nasty. Andrews gives his character a threatening tone that makes him sound effectively scary. The original music score for this film was made by television composer Angela Morley. Her original music for every scene sounds wonderful. She manages to intensify the emotions, thrills, and action on screen thanks to the majesty and sensitivity of her compositions. When a scene needs to sound tense, she gives it her best effort by generating scary orchestral pieces. When a scene needs to sound touching, she delicately puts together a sweet-sounding melody to accompany the touching pictures on screen. I love Morley's work for this film, and I want to check out more of her scores in the future, because her music for Watership Down is versatile, grand, spectacular, and bold. It's capable of moving, frightening, and exciting the audience without distracting us from the imagery on screen. There's an original song featured during Fiver's vision of a black rabbit. This song is called Bright Eyes, and it's performed by Art Garfunkel. Now, some people don't like the sound of Art Garfunkel's singing, but I think that his vocals for Bright Eyes are beautifully strong. He delivers his vocals with convincing sadness. The lyrics by Mike Batt are tragically haunting because they reflect the vulnerability of mortality. The image of Fiver chasing the rabbit Grim Reaper to eerily sung words of death is a powerful collaboration of sounds and visuals. It's a song that certainly left behind an impact because it's what everyone thinks of when one brings up the subject of Watership Down.
Going to join the party, Sean. To conclude, I think that Watership Down is a powerful and riveting film, but is let down by its first half, which goes by way too fast. Sure, it has a creepy scene in the forest at the beginning, but for the most part, the first half doesn't have as much tension or emotion as the second half. Despite this, I still think that Watership Down is one of the best British animated features ever made. Why? Well, it's a wonderful tale of freedom, survival, and teamwork. I'm going to give it 4 parrot stars out of 5. Now, if some of you are still wondering whether Watership Down is up your alley, then consider this. If you liked other survival films like Cast Away and Touching the Void, then you'll love Watership Down too. If you've seen Watership Down and you want to see something similar, then I advise you to check out Diamonds of the Night, my personal favourite survival film. I've been Jambareeqi, and I hope you've enjoyed my 50th episode. Now, how do I end a 50th episode special with a bang? I've got it! Celebrity cameos!
Happy 50th episode, Jambareeqi!
Ah!
Hi, I'm Film Brain. Happy 50th episode, Jambareeqi!
Hey, Jambareeqi. Jew Wario here, just wishing you a happy 50th episode. It's tough to get to 50. It really is.
Hey there, it's Kyle Abear, the voice of the narrator from Dragon Ball Z. Hey, Jambareeqi, happy 50th episode, dude.
Hello, everyone. Uncle Yo, geek-specific stand-up comedian here. See, don't be scared, I can change my shirt. Wishing Jambareeqi a happy 50th review. Here's to many, many more to come. Assuming we still make animated movies and all that. Whee!
Jambareeqi, happy 50th episode, you wonderful little thing, you!
I'm Doug Walkerbell.
Hi, it's Aaron Fitzgerald here, wishing Jambareeqi a happiest 50th episode.
This is Brentalfloss saying, happy 50th episode, Jambareeqi.
Hello, I'm Mike J from That Come With The Glasses, and congratulations to Jambareeqi for his 50th episode. So here's to many more!
Happy 50th episode, Jambareeqi. That's 50 episodes down, 50 more to go, and then another 50, and another 50, and another 50, and another 50, and then all of a sudden you're 45 and you don't know what's gone with your life, and I just don't know anymore! Happy 50th episode. Congratulations.
Jambareeqi Queer! Congratulations on 50 episodes that no one watched. Oh, dear. I don't know why you did 50 episodes, because, like, no one's watching them, but, you know, here's to 50 more that no one will watch either. You should go kill yourself. I mean, I'd kill you, but right now I'm too fucking bored appearing in this video to kill you. Your mother was a Smurf, and your father was embarrassed by having fucked a Smurf.